Please welcome Vice President, Amazon EC2, AWS, Dave Brown.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to the 2021 Compute Leadership Session. It's really great to be back in person. I'm thoroughly enjoying it. I'm Dave Brown, super excited to be with all of you here today and those watching online as well. And this is our 10th reInvent. I've had the privilege of being at every single one of those during my time on EC2. As I said, it's always an exciting time for us at AWS, and specifically our customers as well. And we just love spending time with our customers getting feedback. And hopefully you learned something new here today. This year is also incredibly special for EC2, as we actually had our 15th EC2 anniversary. EC2 was launched on the 26th of August, 2006. And so this year we celebrated 15 years of EC2. I've had the privilege of being with the team since 2007. I actually started as a software engineer back in Cape Town, South Africa. And I can really tell you that back then, we had absolutely no idea what we were building. We certainly didn't expect it to grow into what it's become today. And so that's really been an incredible adventure. And seeing what our customers have been able to build with what we've built has really been incredibly rewarding. So over the next hour or so, we're going to take a look back at the early days of EC2. We'll focus on four critical areas where our customers and customer insights continue to shape the services that we offer today. And we'll take a look at how we continue to build on those 15 years of innovation. And so let's get started with reinventing compute on a global scale. Let's start by taking a look at where we came from back in 2006 when the service launched. 2006 was a very different time. Cell phones weren't yet smart, and no one had even heard of the App Store. The most popular app in the App Store, if there was one, would probably have been Snake 2. Raspberry Pi was something that you ate for dessert. And if you wanted to watch a movie, you still had to order it online, or order it in the mail and wait for it to arrive. Amazon looked a little different too. We were an e-commerce company experiencing tremendous growth. We just launched Amazon Prime, and that was taking off, really seeing unlimited growth. And we were looking for solutions to the complex challenges that we were beginning to see as a company as we continued to grow. And we looked at a few things, initiatives. The first was those to really do an internal assessment to understand what was Amazon good at. And as you would expect, we found out that we were good at online retail, we were great at product detail pages, and we were also getting really good at inventory and logistics management. However, we also discovered that we were really good at running our own data centers and providing reliable, scalable infrastructure services for our online businesses. The second, we had started merchant.com, where Amazon would actually run the online experience for large retail customers, such as Marks and Spencer. And we delivered a solution to the first of these partners. We quickly realized that building the solution was much harder than we actually anticipated at the time. And in the early years of Amazon, we had a whole lot of complex components that were sort of interwoven into our platform. And it was very difficult to actually sell those as components to third-party customers. We also realized that the services were taking a lot longer to actually deliver. And that was when we made a major change. We moved over to what we call a service-oriented architecture, where all of our services are composed of microservices that end up talking together. And this became a mantra that even to this day is how Amazon and AWS build our products. A third, we took a look at internal development projects to really understand what was going into actually delivering on those timelines. We were growing really fast and adding a lot of new engineers, but our delivery times on projects weren't improving in the ways that we were expecting. And so Jeff asked Andy to take a look at this problem to see what he could do. Andy formed a small team, and they discovered that while our estimates were sort of 2 to 3 months end-to-end for most projects, it was actually taking us that amount of time just to build some of the infrastructure that we needed before we even started on actually delivering the project. And furthermore, a lot of that infrastructure actually wasn't scaling beyond the needs of what the team needed for the project that they delivered. And so we realized that we actually had a problem. If we were experiencing this problem and having to reinvent the wheel on infrastructure all the time, surely our end customers and our AWS customers today would have been having the same problem. And the fourth thing we did is we actually, from a merchant point of view, we wanted to provide some of our Amazon services as APIs. And so the information that you see on product detail pages today, we wanted to provide that to end customers so they could go and build tools with our APIs and our data. And what was really interesting about that is we didn't even advertise these APIs in any meaningful way, but the customers came and started to use them, and they actually built services and features that beyond our expectations. We couldn't believe what they were doing. And so that thing surprised us and started to teach us the power of APIs. And so we said if we could build tools and services to allow developers to build an application and run any workload, well, then the operating system is really the internet. You could begin to consume tools and services on the internet to build any application you want. And in the early days of AWS, that was really one of the things we actually spoke about very often, is the operating system is the internet. And we decided to pursue a much broader mission to provide businesses and developers with the tools and services to build almost any application and run almost any workload. We started with a small team, 8 engineers in Cape Town, South Africa, back in around 2004. One of the challenges in being that team in the early days is we were 300 milliseconds away from our nearest data center. I often say continental drift wasn't on our side. And that meant that in an SSH session, it literally took 300 milliseconds to see your keystroke appear on the screen. And we built much of EC2 like that back in the day. But one of the challenges we had was setting up the first EC2 rack. Doing that in a data center 300 milliseconds away was a challenge. And so the first EC2 rack was actually a stack of laptops piled up in the corner of the office. And I was actually fortunate enough, when I joined in 2007, Amazon Frugality, to get one of those laptops as my first development machine when I joined the company. Back then, we really spoke a lot about we wanted to turn compute into a utility, making access to computing resources really as simple as turning on a light bulb. You know, back in the day, when power and providing power to companies and homes was starting getting off, it wasn't uncommon, it was very common actually for most organizations and large industrial companies to actually have a power station on site. And they were typically located way outside of the city, so this big, noisy, and messy power station could provide the electricity it needed. But over a period of time, what happened is as the power grid started to be put into place, these companies started to consume power from the grid, and obviously prices became significantly more competitive. And so a similar change was happening in compute with the early days of the cloud. Instead of buying hardware and putting them into your data center and every organization have to worry about where they run their compute, compute really became a utility that could be consumed within the cloud. In the early days of EC2, customers really dealt with EC2 in much the same way as they did within their own data centers. They would launch an instance expecting to keep it for 3 years. And over the first couple of months and into year 2007, that started to change. And customers said, you know, I could run this instance for a day, or maybe an hour, or maybe just a few minutes. And it was in 2009 that we launched our 1 millionth EC2 instance. That was a significant milestone for us. And we had a big celebration. 4 months later, we launched another 1 million instances, and 2 months after that, another 1 million. And today, we launch over 60 million new instances on EC2 every single day. That's more than 700 instances every single second. This is a huge size and scale and allows us to support every single workload better than ever before. And we're able to help businesses to respond quickly to external challenges. And never has that been more apparent than in the last 18 months. Last reInvent was online, and we talked a lot about COVID in my session and how it had changed the way that we went about our daily lives. And over the last 20 months, the way we learn, the way we work, and the way that we entertain has changed tremendously. And for many of us, just 20 months ago and through 2020, our commute times and carpooling duties were replaced with having to find a quiet place to take our video calls, and with our kids being at home for school and making sure that they had turned in their virtual homework assignments. And this actually put huge pressure on IT leaders to respond quickly to scale their businesses and to meet the demands like never before. And AWS was able to respond quickly by helping to provide scalable and reliable infrastructure capacity and support our customers through this. And we've really seen customers embrace the cloud and move faster to the cloud than ever before. One of these customers was Moderna. And they're also an integral part to why we're able to be here together today. Moderna was transformed from a discovery stage biotech company into a commercial stage biopharma enterprise, developing a diverse portfolio of mRNA-based vaccines and therapeutics. Moderna was actually born in AWS 10 years ago, and we've been their trusted cloud provider throughout this incredible journey. Moderna develops a broad range, or they use a broad range of AWS services to support every aspect of its digital data-driven operations with the goal of reducing the time and cost to bring these new life-saving therapies to market. And they really demonstrate the power of their unique cloud-based strategy in the speed at which they were able to deliver their highly successful COVID-19 vaccine. When scientists at Moderna have a new idea or an experiment, they actually design that within Moderna's drug design studio platform that's actually running on EC2. Scientists can access both public and private libraries of known proteins and design entirely novel sequences. And when they're done, they simply press a button and the sequence goes into production, into a fully automated central lab, and where they're able to actually build the messenger RNA prototypes. At AWS, we love supporting customers like Moderna. And what Moderna is doing is actually high-performance computing. And this has become an incredibly fast-growing area for us. We provide a number of tools, a suite of tools, that help organizations to run large, complex simulations and deep learning workloads in the cloud. And previously, cloud computing power to run these simulations of a size simply was not available. And with the cloud and with AWS and the suite of products and the instances that we provide today, everything from our compute-intensive instances all the way through to some of our GPU-based instances, customers are really able to get this power and run experiments and solve problems that they've never been able to do before. High-performance computing is growing fast, and this is a space that demands continuous innovation to us. When I talk to customers, they're continuously looking for what is the next thing? What are we able to provide? And so it's critical that we continue to invest. And today, I'm very pleased to announce a recent launch that we did, AMD-based HPC optimized instance. This is called the HPC 6A. It's available in a select number of AWS regions. It's based on AMD's Milan processor, which is actually their third generation EPYC processor, and provides up to 96 cores, 380 gigs of memory, and 100 gigabits of networking. The really important point is it offers up to 65% better price performance when compared to similar x86 instances. And so we've done a lot of work behind the scenes to really tailor this instance for HPC workloads while removing a lot of features that aren't really necessary in the HPC space that has allowed us to achieve this price performance improvement. Because of this and our work in the HPC space, we've recently been recognized by the HPC community and actually received 4 awards, including one for the best HPC cloud platform. That's actually the 4th year in a row that we've won that award. And so we're very happy with what we've been able to do there and with our customers. Let's take a look at performance, security, and cost. Over the years, focusing on performance has been incredibly important for us. When we first built EC2, we built it in a very simple way. Actually, one of my favorite interview questions to a new hire has often been, how would you design EC2? And embarrassingly enough, most of them draw on the whiteboard exactly what we did. It was very simple. We used Xen as a hypervisor, and we did a lot of integration and distributed systems work to make sure that we could manage those machines at scale. However, after a period of time, we actually started to experience some challenges in performance. And if you remember back to the early days, customers would often talk about, you know, I really would love to get the bare metal experience. I want virtualization to be as good as bare metal. And the problem was that virtualization actually added a lot of overhead. For us to run that virtual hypervisor, but also for us to run a number of other functions and services that we needed to run, we would steal a few cores from that central processor. We'd steal some of the memory as well that we needed, and maybe a little bit of storage. And actually, many cloud providers still do this approach today. Often, if you look at the largest instance size, you'll see that they don't quite get to all the cores available inside the server. The challenge with that is a thing called steal time. What steal time does is it means that every now and then, that CPU needs to give up what it's doing for your instance and actually say, we need to go and do some work for the AWS management system, or for the networking components, or for the storage components. And so in 2012, we actually started a journey where we said we needed to completely think differently about how we do our virtualization. And we started a journey to say, we need to remove all of the processing that uses that central core onto hardware offload cards. And those hardware offload cards were the very early days of Nitro. We also actually ran on ARM-based processors. And over time, we removed our security, we removed networking, we removed storage, as well as all of our management functions to hardware offload cards, and to a point that where today, we actually use 0% of that CPU memory and storage on the box, and we're able to give 100% of that to the customer. And Nitro system really enables 3 important things. The first one is performance that before had just never been seen on the cloud scale and continues to dominate. Security that is incredibly secure and continue to innovate in that area, and we'll talk a bit more about that later. And then finally, allows us to innovate at a pace that you'll see has allowed us to launch more instances in the last number of years since Nitro than we were able to do previously. So let's take a closer look at performance. Very often when customers benchmark machines, they'll take a look at things like SpecInt 2017. And you'll run that and test that central core and get an idea of how fast it is. And I talk to a lot of customers that actually do that between cloud providers. And you can see there in that graph that very often the results are very similar, because what's happened over the years is the cloud providers have really all converged on a similar CPU, similar SKU from the various providers. But the thing with the Nitro system that you have to think about is, how does the entire application or service perform as a whole? And because the Nitro system is so optimized by ensuring we give you those components, but we've also optimized the way that the components work together, we actually see a significant performance improvement, as high as 26% in some cases, and on average 14% higher when you compare similar instance types between cloud providers. That's a significant level of performance that the Nitro system's providing that you aren't able to get anywhere else, and something we're very proud of. Not only is it important from a Nitro point of view that we allow these components to work well together, it's also important that we continue to innovate and invest in a performance at a component level. Over the years, back in 2013 and 2014, we actually launched the first Nitro network card. A few years later, we launched what we call enhanced storage, which is Nitro to actually manage all of the I/O. One of the areas is storage performance. What's amazing about this graph is if you look at the first bar chart there for the i3 instance, i3 wasn't quite a full Nitro instance yet. That was launched back in 2016. And that's where we started with really high performance SSD NVMe storage. And you can see the Nitro systems, how they've significantly improved, up to 4x improvements in storage performance. And we thought we could absolutely do more. And so today we're happy to announce the introduction of the AWS Nitro SSD. This is an SSD that has been designed and built by AWS for your most storage optimized and storage intensive workloads. Nitro SSDs offer lower latencies because they're tightly integrated with the rest of the Nitro system and provide actually up to 60% lower I/O latency. And very importantly, they provide up to 75% or lower variability. There's less jitter with the Nitro SSD. We've also improved the reliability and the availability. One of the things we looked at is how easily can we update these SSDs? Obviously, in a cloud environment, I never want to take a machine away from you to do anything to it. I want to be able to do those updates while my customer is using the machine. And with Nitro SSDs, we're actually able to seamlessly do those behind the scenes. And then obviously, from a security point of view, as with all of our storage, Nitro SSDs offer AES 256 encryption with ephemeral keys that disappear when you terminate or stop your instance for every single drive that we have. We're also announcing three new instances today that use Nitro SSDs. And the first of those is an Intel-based instance called the i4i that uses Intel Ice Lake, their third generation Xeon processor. It gives you up to 128 vCPUs, 1 terabyte of memory, and 75 gigabits of networking throughput with 30 terabytes of high-performance AWS Nitro SSD NVMe storage. Now, this is a pretty big step forward if you've used an i3. An i3 was still running a Broadwell processor, and so that's giving you 55% better compute price performance and 60% lower storage I/O latency than what you would have gotten on an i3 instance. So this is ideal for workloads such as Microsoft SQL Server, Oracle databases, NoSQL databases, and data analytics workloads. We actually gave one of these servers just a few weeks ago to HammerDB, and they're a benchmarking company, and we said, let's see what you can do with that and how it performs. And HammerDB actually came back and said that the i4i increased performance for Microsoft SQL Server by up to 68% and reduced transaction response times by a full 40% compared to the i3 instance. And it also improved PostgreSQL by 32%. So it's just a remarkable set of results, and I'm sure our customers are going to be very happy with our latest storage-optimized instance. You've obviously heard a lot about Graviton 2 and Graviton in general. And we'll be happy to announce today that we're actually launching two new Graviton instances designed for storage workloads. These names are getting a little long, so bear with me. The first of them is the IM4GN. This instance offers up to 64 CPU cores, 256 gigs of memory, and comes with 100 gigabits of networking. This is really ideal for sort of file systems, NoSQL databases, data indexing and search, and data analytics workloads. It also provides up to 40% better price performance when compared to i3 instances, very similar to what we've seen elsewhere. On the IS4GEN instance type, this gives you 32 cores with 192 gigabits of memory and 50 gigabits of networking. It gives you up to 15% lower cost per terabyte of storage and 48% better price performance than what you got on our i3EN instance. Excited to see what customers do with these new Graviton instances. One of those customers we've been working with is actually Splunk. And Splunk is obviously a leading data platform provider they do a lot of storage with us. And they were evaluating these two new Graviton instances, and they found that they actually decreased search runtime cost by up to 50% over what they were getting with the i3 instance. And so Splunk is really moving in a meaningful way to these instance types. That was performance. Let's take a look at security. And to do that, please join me in welcoming Abby Fuller to the stage. Abby is a principal security engineer with EC2. Abby.
So my name is Abby. I look after security for EC2. And you often hear in a lot of these talks about how at AWS, the security and privacy of our customers' data are our top priorities. And regardless of where these customers are or what industry you're in or what your compliance needs are, customers trust AWS with their most sensitive workloads. But the regulations around where and how you store your data and who has access to that data are becoming increasingly sophisticated. So as customer security needs are evolving, Nitro evolves right along with them. And you heard Dave talk about the trade-offs between security and performance. And with Nitro, we didn't want to trade either of those off, right? So we had to make sure that something kept our security bar and also kept the performance bar high right along with it. So when you're trying to understand these privacy and confidentiality needs, it's really important to know who you're looking to protect your data from. So we often hear from customers that there's a few specific scenarios where they want to see tooling and protection from us. It's privacy from other customers and privacy from the cloud operator, which is us. There are also customers that are looking for more granular control. They want to be able to safeguard their data against their own operators, or they want to be able to split their workloads into trusted and less trusted partitions and ensure privacy between those two components. So we developed Nitro with security in mind from the very beginning. So traditional virtualization uses general purpose servers, right? So they include unnecessary or unused components. And with Nitro, we offloaded a lot of these functions to dedicated cards. And this leads to a smaller trusted computing base. It leads to a smaller attack surface. So Nitro single tenancy reduces the risk of side channels or covert channels or co-location attacks. So that Nitro controller uses a secure boot process so that every step of the system boot can be verified. And if that system receives something unexpected or the firmware doesn't pass the verification checks, the system just fails to boot. Nitro also strictly limits operator access. So there is no mechanism for a system or a person to log in to those underlying EC2 hosts. There's no root user. There's no SSH or interactive access. And lastly, in EC2, our approach to tenancy boundaries are fundamentally different. So for AWS, the only acceptable co-tenancy boundary is a virtual machine, not a container. So this provides you with really strong isolation against other customers or users that are running on that same host. All of these features are enabled by default on EC2 Nitro instances. There's no need to make code changes or lift and shift or adopt new services. Just simply launch a Nitro-based instance. And so we started working on Nitro back in 2013. And since then, it's been the foundation for a lot of our other security investments. So we continue to add new capabilities on top of Nitro to protect customers' confidentiality. So a couple examples so far, and we've talked about a few of them, are bare metal instances, right? So there's no hypervisor running on the host. Customers get totally dedicated and exclusive to all of the access on that underlying system. All of our Graviton 2 and 6 generation instances that are based on Intel Ice Lake have memory encrypted enabled by default. So this is for additional defense in depth against physical attacks at the memory interface level. All local instance storage is also enabled by default. Last year, we announced Nitro Enclaves, which provide a hardened and highly isolated compute environment. So a Nitro Enclave provides a means of protecting particularly sensitive elements of a customer's code and data, not just from AWS operators, but also from the customer's own operators and other software. A Nitro Enclave shares no resources with the underlying host, right? So you only communicate with that enclave via VSOC. And we don't want to stop there. So today, I'm really excited to announce the upcoming availability of Nitro TPM, a trusted platform module on EC2. So with Nitro TPM, EC2 customers will be able to use this trusted platform module to protect secrets or keys or other sensitive info on their EC2 instances. So Nitro TPM can be used for a variety of different things, like authenticating an EC2 instance that's requesting access to a resource, so like a service or a database that has sensitive information. And we can gate that on things like instance health or whether the firmware matches or whether it passes a certain health check. So customers can use those TPM functionalities via built-in OS features. So you can get things like key protection or disk encryption, validation of the boot process, DRM management, and all of that good stuff. So keys protected by Nitro TPM are made available only if the OS has booted correctly. So those boot measurements match the expected values. Just like the Nitro system, if there's tampering detected or if those versions don't match, the system is either fails to boot or with Nitro TPM, those keys are not released at all. So this gives you an additional layer of protection against things like malware that's trying to interfere with your boot process. So Nitro TPM can protect things like your volume encryption keys or the private keys for certificates. Look for more information on Nitro TPM coming soon. And with that, I'll turn it back to Dave. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Evie. We spend an enormous amount of time focused on security within AWS, and that is just critically important, and so really exciting to see what we've been doing in the security space. Let's take a look at the third thing that Nitro enables, which is innovation. Adam showed a similar slide in his talk this morning where he said we now have more than 475 instances available on EC2, and we actually expect that number to hit 500 by the end of the year. So just an incredible milestone. Just an enormous amount of selection, broad selection, of new EC2 instances, rich features, and enhanced security. You can see just from a category point of view, obviously general purpose, memory intensive. We actually have some machines with up to 24 terabytes of memory for very large SAP or in-memory database workloads. We now have networking with 800 gigabits per second, which is just double of what we had last year at reInvent. The pace of innovation continues to increase as well. It's pretty clear from this slide where we launched the Nitro system. You can see there back in 2017 was the first time we launched our C5 instance, which was fully Nitro. And Nitro being made up of these composable components that we can put together very quickly to bring in new technology, whether it's a CPU, a GPU, an FPGA, allows us to innovate very quickly, and we have no plans of slowing down. One of the challenges is I still have some customers running an M1 small. An M1 small is the instance that we launched in 2006 without a name. We only named it in 2008 when we launched our next instance. But customers love them. They say, I have a workload and I just want to be able to use that. And one of the things we've seen out there is that you'll see cloud providers say, listen, you have a year or 6 months or 3 months to get off these instances because we're no longer going to support them. And our customer obsession inside AWS just drives us to want to never, ever be able to deprecate anything. And so what we thought about is how do we actually eliminate the risk of deprecation? What we're announcing today is the long-term support for previous generation instances on AWS. And with this, it essentially means that you can continue to run any instance that you've used on AWS into the future, extended lifetime. We bring in all of the Nitro benefits to Zen-based instances, those instances that launched before Nitro. And so you get in the benefits of enhanced security, the scalability, the elasticity that Nitro brings, but still being able to run that same experience that you had previously. And it's a seamless migration. We're going to be migrating instances behind the scenes, and so you don't actually have to do anything. You'll just continue to be able to run that instance. And I'm in a happier place because I'm never going to have to deprecate any of these instances. So very happy to make that available. Let's dive into the processes and architectures that we support today. Obviously, Intel, AMD, and then Graviton2 are the processes we have to provide you with as broad selection as possible. Starting with Intel, we now have 15 years of collaboration and innovation with Intel on AWS. It's been a great journey from our very first instance launched on EC2, and today we have over 250 instances actually launched with the Intel processor. We've launched a couple of new ones recently, along with the I4I that I just recently announced. We've also recently brought our Ice Lake instances to our memory-optimized, compute-optimized, and general-purpose instances within EC2. Today, I'm happy to announce two new instances in the high memory space with Intel. And this is going to be, again, these instance names are a little long, the X2I in Intel in DN, as well as the X2I EDN instance type. And these are high memory machines focused at workloads that need between 2 terabytes and 4 terabytes of memory. So that's typically your in-memory databases or big data processing engines or electronic design automation, which we'll talk about shortly. These instances actually give you 50% better price performance than the X1 instance that we previously had. Both of them provide that. And both provide 100 gigabits of networking as well, which is critically important when you're trying to rehydrate databases into that amount of memory within the machine. We spoke about electronic design automation, and today we're also launching a new instance called the X2I EZN instance, targeted specifically at electronic design. Now, electronic design automation is what's used when you're designing circuit boards and designing processors. We do a lot of it with Annapurna within AWS. The real difference between this one and the other two is this one provides a 4.5 gigahertz all-core turbo CPU. We actually work with Intel to make sure that all the cores in this instance can burst at 4.5 gigahertz at the same time. This one provides 55% better price performance and up to 40% faster runtimes than the X1E instance, which is the previous generation. We actually worked with a company called Astera Labs, and they're actually a fabless semiconductor company headquartered in Silicon Valley, and they develop purpose-built connectivity solutions for data-centric systems. Astera Labs actually tested the high-frequency CPU on that X2 instance, and they saw up to 25% performance improvement on what they were actually seeing with the R5 instance. So a big step forward, and this is a workload that we've just seen starting to move to the cloud as more and more processors like Graviton are being completely designed in the cloud today. So Intel, you can see the new three new instances there. We'll continue to innovate with Intel and excited to see where we go in the future. Let's take a look at AMD. We brought AMD to the cloud, or AWS, in 2018 when we launched our first two instances with them, the M5A and the R5A instances. Since then, we've actually launched the C5A using their Rome or EPYC 2 processor. And recently, we've also launched or announced the availability of HPC 6A, which is the Milan-based HPC's targeted instance. Customers love the price performance improvement that AMD brings. For an x86 workload, AMD allows you to save up to 10% over the alternative, and also supports seamless migration, so you really do not need to change your application at all. Companies like Expedia have used AMD by moving their services over to AMD-based instances. They've been able to reap that 10% lower cost, and also appreciated the application compatibility and the familiarity of the instances to the Intel alternatives. We're also happy to announce AMD-based general-purpose instance. This is the new M6A instance powered by AMD's Milan processor. This is a big step forward from the M5A instance that actually offers 35% better price performance compared to M5A instances and 10% lower cost than the comparable x86 instances. It has 192 vCPUs, 768 gigabytes of memory, 50 gigabytes of networking, and 40 gigabytes of EBS bandwidth. We actually started to increase the bandwidth from all of our instances to EBS as well, so that you're running applications that really need great performance from the EBS system, you'll start to see that. So happy to have this available, happy to see what customers do with AMD, and we'll continue to innovate with AMD going forward. Finally, let's take a look at Graviton. Adam had some big news around Graviton, so let's dig into that. Our journey in the space started back in 2014 when we actually bought a company called Annapurna Labs. We started working with them. They were a small startup out of Intel, and we really liked the way that they thought, and we found them to be very Amazonian, and so we actually brought Annapurna Labs on board. And they still work very closely with us today, actually designing all of the chips that go into our Nitro cards, as well as our Graviton processors and our other accelerators. We launched our first Graviton instance back at reInvent in 2018. And what we didn't tell you at the time is that was actually the same chip that we used in our network card. And the reason we did that is we really wanted to show the world that ARM was actually coming to the cloud, was going to be a server, not just a mobile device. And we wanted to spark the ecosystem and make sure that customers and application developers and open source applications started to move operating systems to support ARM. And that really worked. It was amazing. And then in 2019, we announced Graviton 2, providing 40% better price performance on a broad range of workloads. And since then, we've actually launched about 12 different instances with Graviton across our portfolio. So we have all of our general purpose compute optimized, network optimized. We also have enhanced memory and burstable. We just launched some storage optimized. So really, any instance you want to go to, you're able to find that price performance improvement that Graviton 2 brings you. Recently, SAP just announced that they'll actually be migrating the SAP HANA cloud to Graviton 2 to take advantage of the price performance benefit that Graviton 2 provides. This is enormous. It's not just the startups out there that are taking advantage, but large enterprises such as SAP that are starting to look to move to Graviton. That ecosystem has just exploded. And so every operating system out there, or at least the Linux-based operating systems, now have ARM support and are able to run on Graviton 2. Container runtimes are able to run on Graviton 2, and we've integrated a significant number, a growing number, of AWS services to Graviton 2 as well, allowing you to take advantage of ARM and the price performance benefits without even having to do any work. Lambda recently launched support for Graviton 2, so you can now run Lambda functions with Graviton 2 as well. One of the first things customers ask me when I start talking about this on a call with them is, well, Dave, how hard will it be? And the perception is that moving to an ARM-based ecosystem is very, very difficult. But in almost all cases, it's significantly simpler than they actually expected. And so I always say to them, listen, take an engineer or two and tell them they have a week, and let's see what they can get done. I actually had an enterprise move in 4 days the other day. Now, I probably wouldn't recommend that you all move your applications, any application to anything in 4 days, but it was amazing to see what they were able to get done because of the rich ecosystem that was able to support their workload. We work a lot with our friends at Amazon that run the bookstore. Internally, we actually treat them like any other customer. And obviously, they have a couple of big days. One of them was just earlier this week. But they also have Prime Day in the middle of the year. And when we work with Amazon Retail, we do a significant amount of capacity planning to support Prime Day. As you can imagine, every year, Prime Day gets a little bit larger and a little bit larger. And they have to land an enormous amount of capacity, compute capacity, to be able to support this workload. And this last year, Prime Day actually increased by 12.5% in size, and they were running over 53,000 C6G instances across three regions. Now, that sounds like an enormous number of instances, and it actually is. But it was actually 6,000 fewer, what we call normalized instances internally, than we actually used in the previous year's Cyber Monday. So even though there was a significant increase in demand, because we moved to Graviton 2, we were able to actually support that workload with fewer instances, getting both the cost saving, but also significantly reducing the power required to actually serve the workload. So just amazing to see what we're able to do with Graviton 2. And then obviously, as Adam announced this morning, we're not slowing down at all. We just announced the availability of Graviton 3. Graviton 3 is looking like a very exciting chip. It has improved performance, up to 25% higher compute performance, and 2x higher floating point acceleration for compute-intensive workloads. It's also significantly better at single-threaded workloads. While Graviton 2 really performed better with multi-threaded applications, Graviton 3 doesn't mind whether it's single-threaded or multi-threaded. It's also the first instance in the cloud to actually use DDR5 memory. As you know, DDR4 was what we've all been using today, and DDR5 actually provides up to 50% more memory bandwidth over DDR4. And then obviously it's more energy efficient, which is not only important from a green point of view, but obviously making sure that we can just generally conserve energy. And so Graviton 3 uses about one third of the energy that you would need from an equivalent x86 instance to actually serve the same workload. So just an incredible improvement in energy efficiency. As Adam announced this morning, we're launching our first Graviton 3 based instance, the C7G instance. C7G gives you 64 vCPUs. They're actually not hyper-threaded, they're full cores. 128 gigabits of memory, 30 gigabits of networking performance, and 25 gigabits of EBS performance. As we said earlier, Graviton 3, 25% better compute performance and 2x higher floating point performance versus Graviton 2. And then the DDR5 memory over DDR4 with a 50% bandwidth improvement. Twitter recently announced that they're migrating to AWS as well. And one of the big reasons that they decided to choose AWS was because of the benefits that Graviton was providing. And so we thought, well, we should probably give Twitter a few of these Graviton 3 C7G instances and see what they could do with some of the workloads they were testing. And Twitter reported back that Graviton 3-based C7G instances deliver between 20 and 80% higher performance improvement versus what they were seeing on Graviton 2-based C6G instances. So again, while it's a 25% improvement over Graviton 2, when you get to the specific workloads, the improvement can be really, really significant. There is actually one more CPU that we support on AWS, and that is Apple Mac. We launched this last year at reInvent 2020. It was all virtual, but it was a very, very fun launch to do. I've been using Mac for a long time, and so this is one of my favorite instance types. The challenge we've had here is that customers, as they move to AWS, very often they say, what do I do with my Mac workload? I have a few Mac minis maybe sitting under a desk somewhere, or I'm having to still pay for some data center space, so I can build Apple applications for the iPad or the Apple TV or the phone or the watch. And so with Apple Mac, you actually get full access to macOS. It's a fully dedicated machine. It speeds up development as well, so your engineers can now get access to these resources in a cloud-like way when they need them, and you can scale on demand. And we've just seen some incredible use cases where customers have been able to get significantly more developer throughput and performance benefits by being able to use Apple Mac on AWS. One of them is Flipboard, one of my favorite applications that I use most mornings to catch up on the news. And they said that build times have reduced by from 20 minutes to 5 minutes. And their UI automation tests used to run in 3 hours, but now actually run in a single hour. And so they've been able to just get incredible throughput in their development pipelines by using Apple Mac on AWS. Let's take a look at another growing space for us, accelerated workloads. We support a number of accelerators today, from Xilinx FPGAs and video transcoding cards to NVIDIA GPUs, such as the A100 and the T4 Tensor Core GPUs. And we also have our own custom developed accelerators, such as AWS Inferentia and Trainium. You know, over the last year, and I'm sure many of you have been involved in this, live streaming has surged during the pandemic and remains at levels previously unseen. And to keep up with this demand, we've had to find ways to cost-effectively scale while continuing to offer customers high performance and low latency for video streaming. Everybody's looking to do it. And so we recently announced the availability of what we call our VT1 instance, or a video transcoding instance, providing the best price per stream in the cloud for live video transcoding. This gives you 96 vCPUs, 192 gigabytes of memory, and 25 gigs of networking, but actually uses a Xilinx U30 card to provide H.264 and H.265 video in full 4K. You can also do 64 simultaneous streams in 1080p, 60 frames per second. And it's actually 60% cheaper versus doing live streaming with comparable EC2 instances. Another internal acquisition we made some years back is Twitch. And they offer live video streaming, specifically in the gaming space, but it's actually grown to an enormous number of live streamers out there across a large array of areas. And one of the things that's become incredibly important is the latency in these live streams, because very often it's actually interactive between you and the individual that's live streaming, and when there's 20 to 30 seconds of delay, it just doesn't work as well. And so with the VT1 instances, we've been working closely with Twitch, and not only were we able to reduce the cost per stream by 75% versus what they were doing, we were also able to reduce the latency down to sub-second. And so you really are seeing that live stream live. It's really exciting to see what we've been able to do there. The other thing that's really taken off is gaming. Obviously, people played more games during the pandemic, but also live stream or streaming of Android games has been taking off specifically, and actually from the cloud, where you have devices that maybe aren't that powerful, so you don't have a GPU locally, and you want to be able to use the GPU in the cloud to actually get that done. And we've had a lot of customers, a handful of customers that have been doing this in a growing space. And what they do is they take a Graviton instance, because it runs ARM CPU, so an Android game runs on that, and then they take an NVIDIA GPU, and they network the two together, and they build this very, very complicated system to actually be able to live stream an Android game with GPU acceleration. The other challenge with that is getting the cost down. The business model requires that the cost per stream needs to be as low as possible, otherwise it really doesn't make sense to do this. And so we took this challenge on, and today we're happy to announce the availability of a new G5G instance, which is the first instance in the cloud that brings together an ARM processor together with an NVIDIA GPU. So this uses Graviton 2, 64 cores, and uses the NVIDIA T4G GPU. It has full support for Android, OpenGL, TensorFlow, PyTorch, so you can also do inference with this GPU, and really allows you to run Android games with a local GPU and stream those to a device. Now, I'm sure all of you are obviously dabbling in Android game streaming, but one of our customers that is doing that is BlueStacks. And BlueStacks actually provides Android game streaming from the cloud to devices. And they've been testing the G5G instance, and they said that both from a technology point of view and from a cost per stream, it's been a significant leap forward in both of those dimensions. And so we're excited to see what customers do with the G5G instance. You know, to support ML workloads, we have a broad selection of different instance types. Many customers choose to train or run inference on CPUs. Obviously, most customers choose to use a GPU, whether that's something like a P4 instance type for training or something like a G4 or G5 that we recently launched for inference. And we also have a number of custom accelerators. And this is an area that we continue to invest in. We cannot invest fast enough, both in our own silicon and bringing other accelerators on board into AWS. We recently launched a new GPU called the DL1, which uses an Intel Habana GPU to actually provide improved, much lower cost for training in the cloud. So up to 40% reduction in training times using a Gaudi accelerator chip from Habana, which is an Intel company. We also announced last year the availability of AWS Trainium, or the preview, or said we were going to be working on Trainium, and we're announcing the availability of Trainium this year. And Trainium actually provides the highest performance in Amazon EC2 for training of very large machine learning and deep learning workloads at a significantly reduced cost, and also integrates with standard ML frameworks. So if you've written an application that uses something like TensorFlow or PyTorch, and it uses something like an NVIDIA GPU, you're able to move between whether it's NVIDIA, Habana, or Trainium, and actually run those same models using that same framework. They all support that. And we're also announcing the availability of the TRN1 instance, which uses the Trainium chip to actually provide you with the instance type that you can use for training. And each instance actually has 16 Trainium accelerators with up to 512 gigabytes of memory, 800 gigabytes of networking. So this is our highest networking instance in the cloud. And what we've seen customers do with it, well, just a few years ago, most machine learning was actually done on a single instance. What's happening here is customers are creating what we call ultra clusters, which is very often thousands of these Trainium or GPU instances all clustered together to really build what's essentially a supercomputer. So very excited to see what customers are able to do with Trainium instances. As we reduce the cost of being able to train ML models, customers are able to run more and more training for these models, and the models are getting smarter and smarter. So it's really having a big impact on the business and the ultimate customer experience. One of these customers is Anthropic. They are an AI company that focuses on safety and research, and it's working on to build reliable, interpretable, and steerable AI systems, specifically in the natural language processing space. They've been doing a lot of work with us on GPUs, but they're also doing a lot of testing on Trainium. And they're super excited about the scale that Trainium brings and what they'll be able to do with it on AWS. So that brings us to the end of our machine learning space with a number of new launches. Finally, let's take a look at compute where you need it. We're seeing customers starting to rethink where traditional applications live and how they can make the cloud their primary model for these applications. You know, in the past, customers have moved applications that they can to the cloud, but there's always been a few applications that they weren't able to move. typically for things like latency. It needs incredibly low, maybe sub-millisecond latency to other applications within their data center. Or it could be data locality, where they've got applications that need access to data that can't be simply moved. And so we've really been looking at how do we extend the cloud and provide you with a continuum from an AWS region all the way through to on-site, potentially even in a remote location. And so we have our regions today. We have local zones, which we'll talk about shortly, wavelength zones. We have our outposts, which allows you to deploy AWS hardware into a colo facility or even your own data center. We obviously have IoT, and we have the Snow family, which is a completely disconnected compute device. And so let's take a closer look at some of our global infrastructure. Obviously, the first thing to do in supporting this continuum of cloud experience is making sure that we have the global infrastructure available everywhere close to our customers. Today, we actually have 25 regions. We have a number of other regions, 8 regions that are currently announced that will be launching shortly. We have 81 availability zones and over 230 points of presence or edge locations around the world. All of those lines you see on that slide are actually our AWS global backbone. Those are actually optical fiber links that we actually own, and traffic, all traffic flows on that. All traffic on those links is also encrypted. And any traffic between regions, as you get onto the backbone, if you like, edge locations, travels along our backbone. And so we had a look at how do we bring this continuum. And so what customers are from local zones was an opportunity for us to actually bring essentially an AWS availability zone close to a metro area. We did the first of these in Los Angeles, where we had media and entertainment customers that were looking for very, very low latency when they were actually doing editing on live video footage that had been taken during the day. And so they had designers overnight sitting and editing, you know, whatever had been shot on the movie set. And so local zones provide very, very low latency access, in many cases as low as 1 or 2 milliseconds, to AWS services and compute within a region, within a local zone. They're also fully managed. You don't have to think about managing, you know, do I need more capacity? We treat it just like we would with our region. And it's new AWS infrastructure available directly in a metro area. Last year at reInvent, we announced the availability, or we said we were going to be launching 15 new local zones across the US. And our goal was really to get within about 10 milliseconds of most of the major metro areas across the US, which we thought would really change the way that customers, you know, use the cloud for very low latency workloads. We've actually launched 12 so far, and in the next 2 weeks, we'll be bringing online Seattle, Atlanta, and Phoenix to close out the 15 local zones that we said we were going to launch last year. Now, obviously, local zones have grown really, really well across the US, and I really encourage you to attend Werner's keynote on Thursday morning to understand what we're going to be doing with local zones going forward. Adam spoke a little bit about 5G, but we've really started to see more use cases using 5G. 5G has a large promise of being able to provide much, much, much higher throughput, but also lower latencies for workloads. And we've seen a lot of customers considering using 5G, not just in the private 5G space that we announced in Adam's keynote, but also more generally supporting users with new phones or being able to support cars or, you know, factories where they need access to very, very low latency and high throughput networking. 5G actually offers up to 10 times the throughput that you could get with a standard LTE network, and then also ultra-low latency, in many cases working to get down to single-digit milliseconds, which really changes the game. A few years ago, we launched AWS Wavelength, which is actually embedding AWS compute directly into a carrier's 5G network. And we did that with a couple of carriers, including Verizon, KDDI, SKT, and Vodafone. And we're actually working with a list, including Bell Canada, a number of other telcos. We'll be bringing AWS compute directly into the network. And by embedding that, it's really interesting what customers have been able to do in these locations, starting to test new workloads. There's a lot of R&D happening where, you know, they maybe never, ever been able to have a video camera that has a 5G chip and be able to stream it directly to the cloud and do all the video editing, including ad insertion and changing cameras, all directly in the cloud. And so it's really offering a lot of opportunities. One of the interesting use cases we did was a company called Origo, and they're based in the UK, and they are pioneering driverless technologies. And they actually launched an autonomous bus service, that sounds terrifying to me, that shuttles passengers from a park and ride on the University of Cambridge. And so AWS Wavelength and Vodafone 5G provide these buses with ultra-low latency and expansive bandwidth that actually lets Origo monitor their autonomous vehicles in real time via safe and secure communications. The assured high bandwidth connectivity between multiple vehicles and the central control room and their servers support critical uses such as remote supervision and first-person video feeds. And this is just one of the innovative things that we're starting to see customers do with 5G and the access to super low latency workloads. Next, let's catch up on AWS Outposts. Now, AWS Outposts started out in 2018 when we actually had, it was actually a telco that came to us and said, I remember the meeting well, they said, listen, we love using AWS, but could you go and put it at the bottom of one of our cell towers? Could you put it into our network? And I remember leaving the meeting thinking there's absolutely no way that AWS would ever do that. We're a cloud provider, we live in regions. And it was about 3 weeks later that the team came up with what became AWS Outposts. And what we realized was we'd actually built all of the underlying technology in the Nitro system with the performance that we had, with the security that Abby spoke about, with the APIs that it doesn't matter how much latency they are between the server and our actual data centers, we're able to easily manage and control these servers, essentially. And so Outpost is the same hardware that we designed for our AWS data centers that we are able to put into your data center. It's fully managed. We manage that server for the entire duration of its lifetime. If a server fails, well, we'll let you know that there's a challenge, or if servers failed, we'll move workloads to other servers within the rack, and we'll even ship you one via Amazon Prime to say, hey, here's a replacement, and you can actually ship the old one back to us. It's all a single pane of glass, AWS API and console. And so if your developers build something in an AWS region or in a local zone, they can just deploy that directly to an outpost. It's exactly the same experience. And so it's really taken off. We've seen a lot of really exciting use cases with that. We've seen a number of customers just across a broad spectrum from banking to Morningstar in the financial industry as well doing migrations, to Dish Wireless, where we're building an entire 5G network, to Riot Games, where they're deploying outposts around the world to reduce latency for new games that they're trying to launch out there. There's an incredibly growing ecosystem. We just announced the availability of two new outposts. Not everybody wants to put a 42U rack into their retail store. And so we thought it's probably a good idea for us to make something in a bit of a different form factor. And so we've launched two new form factors for AWS Outposts. One is a 1U single server that's actually powered by Graviton 2, 64 vCPUs, 128 gigs of RAM, and then gives you 1,900 gigabit NVMe SSD drives. And so it's Graviton 2 performance, low power consumption, great for remote workloads. And we're using a lot of these into cell locations, actually within telco networks. And then the 2U server, which is very similar to the M6i that's available, that's available in the region. And this is an Intel third generation Xeon scalable processor, or Intel Ice Lake. 128 vCPUs, 256 gigs of RAM, and then you also get the SSD storage. And so with these, we think Outpost is something you could really put into a retail location, put into an office location, a branch office, put it anywhere on premises where you really don't want to be able to run a 42U rack. Super excited to see what customers do with these. And how we've been able to continuously focus on extending the cloud. We're bringing more services to Outposts, so bringing Outposts to more countries. We support 65 countries today. And really allowing developers, whether you run in a region, you want to run in a local zone, or you want to run all the way on-prem in an Outposts, it's exactly the same experience from a services point of view. Adam announced, and Adina announced this morning, but this has been something that's just been an absolute pleasure for me and my team to work on, in thinking about how do we bring a workload like NASDAQ to the cloud. Just a few years ago, those were workloads that I said, well, never really run on AWS. And now we're at a place where NASDAQ just announced that they are moving their options trading engine to AWS and actually using AWS Outposts and a private local zone based in Carteret in New Jersey to do that. And so at the end of 22, one of the NASDAQ options trading exchanges will actually be running within a local zone. So just incredibly exciting to see that, and it's a great testament to what this technology is able to do. And so we've been through an incredible amount here today. The past 15 years has really been a whirlwind for us. And for the 11th consecutive year, Gartner has placed AWS as a cloud leader in their Magic Quadrant, ahead of all the other cloud vendors. We're incredibly proud of that, and it's a lot of hard work that happens behind the scenes, but also incredibly a lot of feedback that comes from you, the customer. Our culture of customer obsession empowers us to stay ahead of evolving customer expectations and not only meet what our customers want, but also predict what they might need next. And so it's been great talking to you today, and I'm super excited to see what you all do with this technology next. Thank you very much.